Let us take a few moments to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Amen. Congregation, would you please stand if you would open to number 6 in your hymnal. We'll be singing "This Is My Father's World." Please stand.
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand those wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
Thank you. Please be seated. Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to everyone this morning, those of you that are here, those of you that are watching us live through closed-circuit cable television at the Elmcrest Manor, and those of you who will be watching the service later on in your various electronic devices after we get it downloaded onto our website and YouTube. Welcome to all of you this Sunday, this Super Bowl Sunday, I guess, is the big news today for most folks anyway. So I hope you all have a great day, and don't get too angry if your team loses, whichever one that happens to be. I have some announcements to make. Next Sunday, the Sunday school will be singing during the worship service, and that also means, of course, that we will have snacks in the atrium after the service. You have some information in your bulletin with regard to the Lenten DVD series, and that info is also on the bulletin board. And just make note that we did put up a sign-up sheet on the atrium bulletin board. We are looking for people to provide snacks for that Lenten DVD series, and that information is in the bulletin as well as on the bulletin board in the atrium. Troy Shirley was scheduled to come and be our guest speaker today, but he called me on Thursday and said that he couldn't make it. So Troy will be here next Sunday to speak. You have other announcements in your bulletin. I encourage you to look at those. We have lots of things going on here at church in the month of February. If there's anyone that has an announcement, would you please just come to the microphone at this time? Anyone at all? Last week was Kim's birthday. Okay, so that's three birthdays, because Esther Hazel had a birthday, Strider Bennett, birthday. Any other birthdays? Who? Jack did? Okay. Yesterday, okay. Anyone else? Well, let's sing happy birthday, dear friends.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear friends. Happy birthday to you.
For our pulpit humor this morning, a young man was asked to preach at a camp meeting just before the Sunday morning service. There were hundreds of people that were gathered there on the grounds, and the young preacher panicked. He ran into the bishop's tent. "What shall I do, Bishop?" he asked. "They asked me to preach, but I don't have a sermon ready because I didn't know I was supposed to preach." "Trust the Lord, young man," the bishop advised with great dignity. "Just trust the Lord." Then the bishop marched out of his tent. Frustrated, the young man picked up the bishop's Bible and was flipping through it, hoping to find a verse that would inspire him. Instead, he found some typewritten sermon notes of the bishop's that he liked very much, so he took the bishop's Bible and the notes, and he went to the service. The young preacher amazed everyone with his sermon, and the people crowded around him after the service. Suddenly, the bishop pushed his way through the crowd. "Young man," the bishop thundered, "you preached the sermon that I was going to preach tonight. Now what am I going to do?" "Trust the Lord, Bishop," the young man said. "Just trust the Lord." I find that particularly funny because when I was a seminary student, we were taking homiletics, or some people would call it preaching. Dr. Munson made a reference to an ad on television at that time. It was the old Rolaids ad, and the ad went like this: "How do you spell relief? R-O-L-A-I-D-S. It was for upset stomach and so on. And so he said, when it comes to preaching, he said, "How do you spell relief?" He said, W-O-R-K. So I guess that's true. Anyway, if we have no further announcements and so on, let us stand for our praise song, Spirit of the Living God. It's in your insert. Please stand. Let us remain standing and take a moment to meet and greet one another. If you take your bulletin insert, you'll see there a listing of our prayer requests. Do we have any additions, updates, praises, anything of that sort before we come to God's throne of grace this morning? Anyone in front of me first? Anyone behind me? Well, if not, then let us take a moment to speak to the Lord and share our burdens with him in the privacy of our hearts, and then we'll say together the Lord's Prayer after we have a pastoral prayer. Let's come to him at this time. Father, as we come to you this morning, we are all very much aware that these are times of great unrest, or to put it another way, times of lack of peace across our country. Indeed, throughout the world, this is nothing new in the history of the world either. Your word tells us that we are to pray for and to work for peace. And so we ask that you would help us in that endeavor all across our country and all across the world. Father, we also lift up those who are on our prayer list this morning. There are those that are battling and struggling with the COVID-19. Our community, our state, our country, all over the world. We ask that you would pour out your healing for those who are struggling with this, that you'd bring an end to this epidemic. We pray for those who are recovering from various kinds of surgeries, that you would completely restore them. Your word tells us to pray for those who are in positions of leadership, be it the church or be it in our governments at various levels. We ask that you would help us all to seek your face as we make so many decisions that affect other people's lives. We pray for the church throughout the world, those who are being persecuted. We ask that you would send help, that you would bring deliverance, that you would keep them strong in their faith, wherever they may be in the world and whatever their circumstances they're battling with. Give them endurance and peace amidst their trials and their tribulations. We pray the same for us, even though our struggles may be different than those. For all these things and others that perhaps were not put into words, we ask that you would search our hearts and minds, examine our burdens, our needs, and our concerns, and minister to those as well. We turn them all over to you at your throne of grace. And we do this in your Son's name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Holy God, you have invested in all of our lives through your Son, Jesus Christ. And so this morning, through this offering, we are investing in letting this community, indeed in some sense the whole world, both know about and that they might also experience your love. We ask that you would receive our giving in Jesus' name, and that you would empower it through the power of your Holy Spirit, for it's in your Son's name that we ask it. Amen. Please rise for offertory response. All blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above the heavenly host, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. you. Please be seated. Turn with me, if you would, please, to the Gospel of John, chapter 4. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 15 and 21 through 26. We're continuing our sermon series, if you will, and then going through the Gospel of John, and you've got the sermons listed there in your bulletin, and so we're at this passage of Scripture that we, at least is commonly referred to as the woman at the well, or the Samaritan woman at the well, whatever you want to call it. That's where we are. Starting in chapter 4 and verse 1, you've got the page number indicated there if you're reading from the blue Bible that is in the pew rack in front of you. The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is very deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his flocks and his herds?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." And then skipping down to verse 21. Jesus declared, "Believe me, woman, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I who speak to you am he." Water. How important is water in your life? I suppose at one level, we probably take water for granted, don't we? We can run to the water fountain at the church or at school. We can turn on the tap and get water in pretty much any building that you go into. So at one level, it's pretty easy, I think, to take water for granted. On the other hand, if you're raising livestock, if you're in the farming, ranching business, you have to have water for your livestock, don't you? So when we have winter temperatures like now, you have to make sure the water is unfrozen. It can be a chore, can it? Water's kind of important then, isn't it? Or water can be important if you're in kind of a desert environment. I still marvel when I read about our American history as people traveled from the East Coast across the country to the West Coast, how important water was. You could only carry so much with you. People that were leading wagon trains, or if you were out there on your own with your family, You had to know where the lakes were, where the rivers were, where the water holes were, whether those would be dried up at certain times of year. You had to know when you could go through mountain passes and when you couldn't, because they'd be impassable in the winter. And water was critical for those people, the pioneer days, as we like to call them in our American history. Water was no less important in Jesus' day either. Nope. Roaming around the desert, you'd better have water with you, or you'd better at least know where water was going to be available, or you could die. In verses 1 through 3 in this passage of Scripture, it tells us that Jesus is leaving the region of Israel called Judea. Judea is in the southern portion of the nation of Israel. And he's going to go to the northern portion, an area called Galilee. So you got Galilee in the north, Judea in the south, and there's a tract of land right in between the north and south called Samaria. This is where he has an encounter with this woman at the well. And it tells us in verse 6, if you look at that, it says it was the sixth hour. Now, don't take that to mean 6 a.m. or 6 p.m., because that's not what it means. Their clock was different from ours. We basically start at midnight and we go for 12 hours and then another 12 hours. But their clock started at 6 a.m. in the morning. So 6 hours from 6 a.m. means it was right around noontime, hot weather in that region, when Jesus has this encounter with this woman at the well. She's there to draw water at noontime. Now, why on earth would a person with any brains want to be carrying buckets of heavy water at noontime? We don't know the answer to that. We could speculate. Maybe she had an ill reputation and she didn't want to be around her townspeople. Maybe she had to carry water for hired workers. We don't know why she would come at noon in the heat of the day when she could easily have come early morning or in the evening when the temperatures were cooler. But whatever the reason, Jesus has an encounter with this Samaritan woman right around noontime when it's hot. And I don't think that it is any accident that Jesus meets up with this woman at the well around noon. I think Jesus knew full well that that woman was going to be there at that time. Jesus has sent his disciples off into town to get some food. So Jesus is one-on-one with this woman at the well. And Jesus says a bunch of things that are very surprising to this woman when they start having their conversation. Jesus asked her for a drink of water. Now, given the circumstances, to us that wouldn't seem odd at all, would it? You're out in the hot sun. Jesus has been traveling. This woman has been carrying a bucket of some sort to bring water back. Usually the wells were outside of the town, so we don't know what distance she had to walk from town to where the Jacob's well was. We don't know what the distance was, but apparently it was a chore to carry the water back and forth from the well. Jesus is hot and tired from his journey. He didn't get it in his beamer to travel in Israel. He walked. Hot weather. So he logically asks for some water from this woman who has a bucket and a means to draw the water out of the well. Doesn't seem to be anything unusual about that, but this woman is very, very surprised, maybe even shocked, that Jesus would ask her for some water. Why? Well, there's some history between Israel and the Samaritans that tells us why this woman is shocked. First of all, in their culture, in their day and age, Jewish men would not speak to even Jewish women when they're out in public. Rarely did they do that. And they certainly wouldn't speak to a Samaritan woman who they thought of as their enemies, or in some cases, second-class Jews. Now, in Samaria, you had both Jews and non-Jews. When you read in the Bible and that you see the word Greeks, that just means non-Jewish people. And so remember, you got Jews in the north, Jews in the south, Samaria's in the middle geographically, and so you've got people there that are not Jewish. You've also got some Jewish people mingled in there. And she's a Samaritan. Samaritans were hated by the Jews. Why? Well, they had some disputes. One of the disputes was when the nation of Israel left Egypt and spent 40 years in the desert wandering around and then eventually crossed the Jordan River into the Promised Land. God told them to build a stone altar on Mount Ebal to do their sacrifices that he required of them. But what did the Samaritans do? Their version of the law, they took out Mount Ebal and they put in Mount Gerizim. Well, that was considered heretical to the Jewish way of thinking, to change the location where God said to make the sacrifices and the offerings. So there was animosity over the location of where the place of worship would be and where the places of sacrifice would be. That was one of the disputes between them. And a Jewish person would not drink from the same cup or pitcher or eat off the same plate as a Samaritan. So the woman is shocked when Jesus not only speaks to her as a woman and as a Samaritan woman, but because of the historical animosity between the two. And there's other historical reasons why they didn't like each other, and we won't get into those today. One other one I probably should mention, though, is the Jews accepted all of what we call the Old Testament as authoritative scripture. But the Samaritans only accepted what they call the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. The rest of it, they didn't accept. So that was another bone of contention between them. So naturally then, understanding that, the woman is shocked that Jesus would ask her for water, ask her for a drink. But he asks her for a drink there in verse 7, and then in verse 10, he says that he's going to give her a drink. And she says, well, how are you going to do that? It would be a miracle, Jesus, if you did that, because you don't have anything to draw water with. I'm the only one that has something to draw water out of this well with. And now she's getting really confused. In addition to Jesus violating all of the cultural norms to have a one-on-one relationship and conversation with this woman at the well, he also is making a claim to be able to do something that is not possible to do. And he tells her that the water is a gift of God. He calls it living water. She doesn't understand what he means by living water. She thinks he's talking about the water from the well. But she thinks that that's probably a good deal, because Jesus tells her that anyone who drinks of the water that he's going to give them will never thirst again. Now, how do we know she's thinking of the water in the well? Because she says to Jesus, well, yeah, give me some of this water, then if I'll never thirst again, that means I'm not going to have to make this journey from town to the well in the hot sun and then with the heavy bucket, or buckets plural as the case may be, go back to town. She's still thinking he's talking about the water in the well, physical drinking water. We all know that that's not at all what Jesus was talking about. But she hasn't quite gotten the picture yet when Jesus talks about giving her living water. She thinks he's going to do some miracle, or at least claim to do a miracle, so that she'll never thirst again if she drinks the water that Jesus gives to her. I don't know what she thinks he's going to do. Scripture doesn't tell us that. But she knows it's living water. She knows that Jesus claims that he can give it to her. And Jesus says that if she gets this living water, it will be like a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Now he's starting to focus in and start giving her a little hint that it's not water that you drink from a well or from a faucet that he's talking about here. She still thinks it's a special kind of physical water. But he's talking about eternal water. Not physical water, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. That's what he means when he's talking about living water. The Bible tells us that when we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells in our bodies. In John, in the 7th chapter, he talks about, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. Context, Holy Spirit. And he says in verse 22, salvation is from the Jews. In other words, eternal life, salvation, this living water, the Holy Spirit, it comes historically through the Jews. And then Jesus starts talking about true worshipers. They said they must worship the Father in spirit and the truth. There has to be a common bond, Jesus is telling her, between God in heaven and his, what he calls here, true worshipers. There's got to be a connection. There's got to be a link. It's got to be something that's personal. It's got to be in a personal relationship. True worshipers must worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The only way we can be in communion with God the Father is through his Holy Spirit. There are people I've met that have been in churches for years, even decades, that have never received Jesus into their life, which means they've never received the Holy Spirit. They go to church, they go to Sunday school, they go to worship services, whatever it is that they're going to in church, but they don't have that connection between themselves and God because they haven't received the living water, the Holy Spirit. And it's a shame. They're missing out because God wants them to have it. Only then can they worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And then toward the end of the passage there, she says, well, I know that when the Messiah comes, he will teach us all things. And then Jesus reveals himself and he says, I'm the Messiah. I think this is the first time in Scripture where Jesus comes right out and says he is the Messiah, the Christ, the Anointed One, the Son of God. Before even he ever says that directly to his own disciples, he tells this woman at the well. He says, I am he. People today are looking for the living water. They're looking for that thing that's going to bring them refreshment. Not refreshment from water from a fountain necessarily, or from a Kool-Aid or a lemonade or whatever. No, people need the living water. But a lot of them don't know that that's what they really need. And for those that know that they need something, something is missing in their life, they don't know where to find it. And Jesus, I think, goes out of his way to let this woman at the well know that what she needs is him, Jesus. He can bring her and give her the living water. And the Bible tells us that's our job, too. To let people know that Jesus is the Messiah. To let people know that he is the one who can give them not only forgiveness of their sins, but the living water, the Holy Spirit, to dwell in their hearts, to make their lives whole and meaningful, to be in a personal relationship with God through the Holy Spirit. All of that is involved with these two words, living water. At this time, congregation, if you would please stand, if you would open in your hymnals to number 662, we'll be singing "Let Your Heart Be Broken." Let your heart be broken for a world in need. Feed the mouths at hunger. Bleed. Give the cup of water and the loaf of bread. Be the hands of Jesus serving in his stead. Here on earth applying principles of love, visible expression. Let us bow our heads for the benediction. Our most gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks that we can learn from you just in the way that you taught the woman at the well, even though you're not here bodily, through your spirit and through your word. You can teach us and lead us and guide us into all of the mysteries of you. And all of the blessings that we enjoy because of your love and your grace for us by giving your Son to die on the cross for our sins. We give thanks for all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.